Father, I want to pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for this opportunity to come into your house of worship and praise. You said men shall not live off of bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of your mouth. I thank you, God, that you see and know all things. You know our ins and our outs. You know where we really are. And you love us where we are. Now, Father, as we go into your word, I pray that you would open the hearts of your people. I sense, God, the things that are going on in the hearts of your people. And I thank you that there's answers. There's answers to overcome. And I pray in Jesus' name that God, that like you told Timothy, to stir up the gift, that every person in here will stir up the gift of God that's on the inside of them, that they'll find themselves encouraged through the word of the Lord. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. 2 Corinthians chapter number 3. We're going to look, I'll read verse number 7, and we'll read down. It says, but if the ministration of death, written and engraved in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glorious, or glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded. For until this day remaineth the same veil, untaken away. In the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image. From glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. You may be seated. Somebody say transformed.
Transformed.
Read out of the book of 2 Corinthians. Paul, once again, is writing a letter to the church that's at Corinth. And what he's writing to them about is a mindset. Someone say a mindset.
A mindset.
Look at your neighbor, say, we got to break out of that mindset.
We got to break out of that mindset.
This mindset is a mindset that says that where I am and how I am is the way I'll always be.
All right.
Is a mindset that says I'm not worthy of the presence of God. It's a mindset that says, I'm not worthy to be intimate with God. It's a mindset that says that even if everybody else excels in the Lord, that I'm going to be stuck where I am the rest of my life. It's a mindset that says depression's just my friend. It's a mindset that says that the way I see myself is just the way I see myself. It's just the way I am. It's a mindset that will send someone else to God and rather have intimacy with God through a man than to grow in intimacy with God themselves.
is a mindset and say, Pastor, go for it. I see the glory of the Lord all over your life. You can do it. You can be it. You're a great example. But for me, I'm going to always be stuck in this place. I'm going to always be going through. Why? Because my family was broken. You saw the skit earlier. My family was broke up. I didn't have both parents in the house. I was mishandled as a child. I was abused verbally, physically, emotionally. You don't understand, Pastor. I was in an abusive relationship. And in that relationship, that person beat me with their hands, beat me with objects. They told me everything but that I was a child of God. And they went to church. So maybe that's for everybody else. That's not for me. That's the mindset. And so what happened is, if you were to go back into scripture, you'll find that Moses, he messed around and stumbled upon the Lord. Somebody say he stumbled upon the Lord. Because Moses wasn't looking for God. Moses was a murderer. He was running away from his homeland where he had grown up. He ran away from his family. He ran away from everything that represented his upbringing. He had an accidental encounter with God. Yes. And in that encounter, Moses learned who God was first. Yes. For those that want to take notes, you should write down that Moses learned who God was first. Because before you'll be able to understand who you are in God, you've got to know who God is. God says, I don't mingle myself up with worldly things and worldly cares. He said, I don't mingle myself up with passions and lust and desires. He says, I'm God and I'm holy. He said, in fact, what you've used, what you've walked upon, your life situation, your life circumstances, I need you to kick those sandals off of your feet because I want to introduce you to something that's divine. Those sandals represented Moses' story. Those sandals represented Moses' struggle. Those sandals represented Moses' broken home. Because it doesn't matter if he grew up in the palace. He still did not grow up with his family. There was a place in his heart that was hurting. There was a desire in his heart to know the truth, to be reacquainted with his blood. To the point that in trying to find that, he stumbled upon a situation where one of his own was being abused. He stumbled upon a situation where one of his own was being beaten. He stumbled upon a situation that even though he should have been one of those slaves, he saw the abuse that was happening in the life of another. Not knowing God, he responded the only way that humans know how to respond. Moses responded in anger. He responded with the blood of loyalty that says, these are my people, and I refuse to let somebody damage or hurt my people. How often have we found ourselves dirty and up our hands for what we saw as a righteous cause? How often have we looked at a situation of injustice and we said, this isn't fair? And we responded in our own emotion and dirtied up our hands. Whether it was you disrespecting your parents, whether it was you not listening to authority, whether it was you determining, I'm out of this house, I ain't staying here no more, leaving at tender ages like 13, 14, 15, 16. You let the emotion stir up a response that every human being ought to be able to relate to outside of an encounter with God. Look at somebody and say, we need the Lord.
We need the Lord.
And so what happened is, Moses had to flee because in his emotions he murdered someone. How many people found ourselves leaving a situation because we responded wrong and we end up damaging the people we were supposed to be setting an example for? In any case, ran to the land of Midian and said, I'll just serve the rest of my life. Stumbled upon a mountain. Ran into a burning bush. That burning bush carried the essence, the characteristics of our Almighty God. That bush burned but was not consumed. Moses was introduced to the supernatural. You see, God is invisible, but he has ways of showing himself to us in our everyday lives. God, you could not see him with your natural eyes. The Bible said you die, but yet he will give you evidence that he's real. And for some of us, that's all we needed. We needed to know that wherever we were at and whatever we were doing, that God was real. Then a voice comes calling out of this bush. It says, take your shoes off. This ain't every ground. You're not dealing with every person. And this is not every situation. This situation is different than all, for I'm holy. Holy means it doesn't matter how much you were mishandled, you won't be mishandled by God. Holy means that it doesn't matter how much you were misunderstood, you will not be misunderstood by God. Holy means no matter what your upbringing, whether the daddy wanted to leave you or whether you were that daddy that left, that in this moment you'd encounter Almighty God. You'd be introduced to a love that's unconditional, that never shakes and never changes. You'd be adopted into a relationship with Almighty God that will last for eternity. In that moment, excuses. In that moment, inadequacies are incinerated. In that moment, discrepancies, they go away. Amen. In that moment, something bigger arises in your view than just you. Moses encountered God. As a result, God introduced himself to Moses. And then God introduced Moses to himself. He told him who he really was. He said, I've got a work that I want to do through you. And you know, Moses, like us, the first thing we start thinking about is what we don't have right. First thing we start thinking about is, God, how you going to send me to a people that I used to damage? Y'all not hearing me. How you going to send me to a people that I used to curse out? The people that I used to hang with? How you going to send me to a people I used to sell dope to? That doesn't make any sense. How you going to send me to a people that I abuse? How you going to send me to a people? God says, don't say you're inadequate. Because all I'm asking you to do is declare me to my people. Look at somebody and tell them, God wants you. Declare God to others. The misconception is that we're supposed to be great and strong before we can do anything for God. The misconception is we've got to get ourselves, Mr. All together before we can speak for God. The misconception is that leaders go home and they're in a bed of roses and they've got butterflies running around their heads and doves ascending and circling them everywhere they go. When the truth of the matter is, leaders deal with things too. Leaders deal with fears too. Leaders deal with insecurities too. Leaders find themselves wanting to give up too. Leaders ask God questions why too. But God says it's not about how weak or how strong you are, because I'm only asking you to declare my strength. If it was up to your strength, yes, don't even start the journey. But in this situation, I don't need your strength. I need you to declare my strength. Somebody say his strength.
Paul declared that his strength is made perfect, complete, whole, mature, full strength in our weakness. So when Moses said, God, I have a stuttering problem, I can't speak that well, God says, you're the right type of person for me to use. Because I know that you'll tell them my message and not your own. Come on, somebody. One of the hardest things when an employer is going through resumes, he got to find the right fit, because some people are qualified but headstrong. That type of person will take a business down. No matter how skilled they are, no matter how much experience they have, because they don't fit with the flow, they can't even be hired, because that headstrongness, it'll cause them to damage the flow of the business. And so God is the same way. We're saying this person's got this, and this person's got that, and that's why they're qualified. And God says, I'm looking for somebody who will put all of their trust in me. Who qualifies for that? We all do.
Praise God.
Look at somebody and say, I qualify for that. Tell them, I'm imperfect. But I believe in God. Give your hands and give that praise. What happened is that encounter with God, it began to transform Moses' life. The reason why we're not seeing lives change like we're supposed to is because people are not having encounters with God. Not encounters with men who think they're Christian smart. I'm talking about encounters with God. I'm talking about encounters with God. I'm talking about encounters that move the spirit in a man. I'm talking about encounters that causes the soul to line up with the will of God. Encounters to where you never doubt again. Even if the whole world begins to doubt, you say, God, you reign. You're not just the God of my current present situation. And you're not greater than whether or not you meet what I need you to do in a moment. My God's bigger than that. I serve a God, a manifestation of God who will reveal himself to me. I serve a God that would do the impossible. I serve a God that will introduce himself to me in ways that only God can get the credit for. It's what wakes me up in the morning. It's what lays me down at the end of each day. It's what rises me up to love the Lord and to live for the Lord another day. It takes a God encounter. God desires so much for people to allow him to show forth through their lives. But he has to battle the self-will. And so people that want to believe don't believe, because we're not showing God. We're showing ourselves. You say, Pastor, what's that got to do with anything? When Moses came off that mountain, he was not the same man. He was transformed. When he came out of the presence of the Lord, his countenance was different. The veil wasn't some cosmetic hookup. The veil was necessary because the glory of the Lord shined so brightly upon Moses.
Moses' face that the people were blinded by the glory of the Lord. He was changed. Somebody say, I want to be changed. Say it again. I want to be changed.
I want to be changed.
Moses was changed. Now, let me make sure I make this straight for you. He wasn't looking for God.
That's right.
He stumbled upon God. But the revelation that he got of God on that mountain, it changed his life forever. The glory of God shines so brightly upon him. Oh, God, I want your glory to shine upon my life so bright. Where is the cry for your glory, God, to shine in our lives? Where is the cry? I know people are trying to push their agenda, and they're swallowed up with the worldly concerns and trying to show face to the world. But God, where are the people that say, just give me your glory? I want your countenance to shine on me. I want people to look at me and know, this is somebody that had an encounter with Almighty God. Somebody that's going to make God real. And not just a sometimey situation in a place of crisis or need. Moses came down, and it wasn't his desire to wear a veil. But the people couldn't handle what he got from God in that God encounter. In their hearts, they weren't ready, people of God. I want you to stay focused. They weren't ready for that encounter. So he had to wear a veil just so he could deal with the people. That was old covenant. Somebody said that was old covenant. And so when we go into the text for today, there's a comparison of glory. That glory was awesome. Yes. Moses made an invitation to the people saying, come on up the mountain if you desire. But when they saw the fierceness of the Lord and they heard the thunderings and the lightnings, all of a sudden they said, no, Moses, I'm not going. I'm not touching that mount. You go for us and just send us back word on whatever God is saying. Amen. And that's how many of us are. Go, Pastor, go. Go, Pastor, go. Going on up the mountain, hear from the Lord for all of us. But I've got a newsflash. The veil was broken. It was torn in twain. It was torn in two. That veil, Moses, where it was symbolic of the veil that would be in the temple, that when Jesus died on the cross of Calvary and said, it is finished, it was torn from top to bottom. At that point, it wasn't about seeing God just simply through another man. But God says, I want to have fellowship with all that would receive me.
Come on. Hallelujah.
And so, the glory that Moses experienced and the people saw, as the scripture said, it was second rated in comparison to what was to be released into the life of every born-again child of God. And this ought to be the most exciting news. But unfortunately, we want the old model. Pastor, I come to get my word. Then I want to go home. Pastor, I come so you can lift my spirits, so I can go on about my life. Pastor, I come so you can ease my conscience, so I can say I got some God time this week. Pastor, I come so you can pray for me because I've got situations going on in my life and I don't know what to do. And it's not that that's bad. New Covenant, New Testament shows where the men and women of God, they stand in strategic places to help uphold the saints of Christ. Yes. But whenever we say, send him, but I won't go.
Right.
We defame and we defraud the cross.
and everything that Jesus sacrificed his life for. The Word of God says in verse 13 of 2 Corinthians chapter 3, "And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. Their minds were blinded. Their minds were blinded, for until this day remained the same veil, and it hasn't been taken away." It's like having $1 million sitting right in front of you, but you got blinders on your eyes, and you're complaining about your struggles. That's what this situation was. The mindset, we've been blinded in our minds. I was sharing with my wife on the way to church. I said, "Sweetheart, it's difficult sometimes. Because for some reason, especially in areas like where we are now, people don't respond unless you bark at them. Unless you raise your voice. Unless you build some type of situation of inferiority. Unless you dominate. Unless you use a strong arm. People don't respond. It's difficult because if you give them this liberty that the scripture talks about, they don't take it. And so their ministry is not liberated. They're waiting for you to boss them around. What do you do when everybody said, "Boss me around and I'll do it. Boss me around and I'll do it. Boss me around and I'll do it"? If that is not blinded in your minds, if that's not the enslaved mindset that keeps us in bondage, then what is? Yes. Majority of the churches, they'll go with that model, the old Mosaic model. And they'll say, "Just look to me. I'll show you the way to go." But the scripture says that way was abolished. Abolished is a strong term. That means it's done away with for good. It does not exist anymore. My God, I feel heaven. It doesn't exist anymore. And so if it's being manifest, that means it's vain. It's not true. It's not God. It's not real. So to function there is to function in the place of falseness. In deceit. But our minds have been blinded through our circumstances, through our hardships, through our pains, through our struggles. We have not a high priest, hallelujah, who's not touched with the feelings of our infirmities. That's our weaknesses. The Bible says he was tempted in every point. He was tested and tried at every point, just as we are, yet without sin. And so when sharing something like this, it's not to say, "How dare you be where you are?" It's more so to say, "Don't let the devil deceive you. There's more that God has for you than what you're reaching for." Come on, somebody. There's more that God has promised than what you're experiencing. God wants you to be able to have an encounter with. I know that people say God doesn't reveal himself that way, but I'm here, and he's revealed himself to me. So that's a lie. You're here, and he's revealed himself to you. So that's a lie. So the best thing that we can do is to ask God to remove the blind. Somebody say, "Lord, remove the blinders."
Lord, remove the blinders.
Why do we like somebody barking at us? It's because that's how we grew up. Mama didn't get our attention until she cussed us out. Why are you used to somebody bullying you around? Because that was our upbringing. A lot of bitter people trying to keep our anger back, but we barking at everybody we come in contact with. And so the only way we know how to receive communication is if somebody's barking at us. You tell me that's God. Look at somebody and say, "That's not God." Say, "Don't receive that." Look at them in their eyes and say, "Don't receive that."
I don't know about y'all. If I found out that that's what the enemy was getting me on, I wouldn't like that anymore. If I found out that I have lifted myself in those mirrors with such low esteem that I felt like I had to be beat and I deserved to be beat, I say, devil, you're not getting me that way no more. Where are the people of God? We declare we were grown up in the streets, but when it comes to fighting in the spirit, we act like little wimps. But where are the people of God that said, Satan, you will not bully my line? Maybe that's how it was before my encounter with God. But good God Almighty, when I had that encounter with the Lord, it changed everything. I don't look at myself the same way. I don't see life the same way. Now I see life through God's lens. And God's lens gives me insight about myself that without Him I would have never known. I would have never known to pursue. I say oftentimes that we learned how to live in bondage. Now we have to learn how to live free. I'm going to say it again. We grew up enslaved. Wherever you were from, I promise you there was slavery there at some point, sometime. And however it was received or however we responded or reacted, that thing went into our nature and it started to reciprocate in the next generation. Amen. And the next thing you know, instead of seeing ourselves as God sees us, we don't see ourselves the way we should. Amen. So when somebody look at us and call us out of our name, you use the derogatory terms. We expect it. It's almost like we understand that more than beauty. Like we understand that more than we understand love. We understand abuse more than we understand affection. We understand strong, loud, angry tones more than we understand calm, tender tones. Why? Because we've learned how to live in bondage. God wants to teach us how to live free. And I recognize even allowing God to share this message that some of us don't want to.
Amen.
That's the conflict with this ministry. I'm not going to take advantage of you in your weak state. I refuse. I've committed my life to building. Never to take advantage of where you are in your weak states. Never to use the fact that you may be troubled in your identity. Right. To esteem myself or to make myself look good. In other words, I'm not playing Moses in your life. God has great promises for each and every one of us. I refuse to play Moses in your life. I'll be your brother. I'll be your sister. But I will not be your God. Was red. That means everybody has a right. You listen to the skit, one of the people felt like they didn't have a right to go before God. And that's how some of us have felt. We have been ridden in sin, overwhelmed by obstacles and hardships. But the Bible says that that model was abolished. It does not exist today. The idea of idolizing a man who hears from God and you don't. I'm going to tell you, in simple terms, to adopt that is satanic.
Amen.
Abolish, according to the word, means abolished. Everything that we do in ministry, he set apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers and evangelists to build us up in unity. But the Mosaic structure of ministry and leadership, that was abolished. And the reason why we don't feel nothing when we come to church is because we've been tempered to not feel anything. Get your feeling through your pastor. You don't have to have a relationship with God. It's not expected of you to grow in God. It's not expected of you to talk to God. And it's not expected of God to talk back to you. And as a result, we're missing out
on that intimacy that God promised to have for us through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. Tell somebody, I won't be blind no more. Verse 15, but even unto this day when Moses is read, the veil is still on their heart. Nevertheless, when they shall turn to the Lord, the veil is going to be what?
Taken away.
When it turns to the Lord, what's going to happen?
The veil is going to be taken away.
Now I want you to read it again like you believe that that's what God's doing in your life.
Thank you, Lord.
What's happening again? But even unto this day, when it's read, the veil is on the heart. But number 16 says, nevertheless, when what? That means that there will be no barrier. It's the most exciting news in the world, but with blinded minds, you can't even receive it. But it's the most exciting news in the world to know that I can have intimate fellowship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's been downgraded, and I understand. Facebook has been lifted up, and God has been pushed down. But to have intimacy with the Creator of the heavens and the earth, to have intimacy with the one that created all of the universes and the galaxies, to have intimacy. What a mighty says, now the Lord is that spirit. And where the spirit of the Lord is, that's freedom.
Freedom.
I told you we've known bondage, but we've never known freedom. God wants to teach us what it's like to live free. How do you live free? You find out what God has to say about you. You find out about the endless love that he has for you. And as a result, you live your life not to please man or to measure up to man, but you live your life totally to please God. And the sanctuary should have gone into a thunderous applause. But because the enemy has a clamp
come on
the minds of God's people, they're no different than the Egyptians and the Israelites, where God promised them and paved the way for their freedom. And they said, take me back to Egypt. I like Egypt better. Pastor, why won't you just go with our flow? Pastor, why don't you just come in, preach your message, let the praise team sing, give the children the opportunity, you know, and we can all go home, we'll be happy, we'll even give more. That's what the heart is saying. You fight not to look at your watches to see what time it is so you can get out of this situation. And you don't even know the liberty that God has for every one of us in this world. Verse 18 says, but we all, that means all of us, with open face, we behold, as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, and are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. Now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And so we're changed as we behold him as in the glass. We're changed as we look upon him. We're changed to the same image, and we're changed from glory to glory. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. In other words, I'm being changed. Every moment I live life in the Spirit, I'm being changed. Every moment I give God of my heart and of my soul, I'm being changed. That change means metamorphosis. Like a caterpillar turns into a butterfly. In other words, if you know a caterpillar, it lingers on the ground at a slow pace. But a butterfly, it'll soar in places that a caterpillar could never go. That's what he means by changed. Why are we wallowing in this place of depravity? As a caterpillar, when God has promised us through Jesus Christ that we can soar. Why complain about the objects in front of you when he can transform you and you can simply rise above them? God is changing us if we want to be changed. At this point in this time that we're living in, it's a lot of stuff being pushed. It's a lot of glamour. But where are the encounters with God? Where are the encounters that cause us to pause? Where are the encounters that make God big and make everything else small? When you ascend into an airplane, it's a view that can take your breath away. Because before the invention of airplanes, there was no opportunity to see God's creation like you see it in the plane. When you look from high, you recognize the works of God's hand. When you ascend into the clouds and you recognize that there's another realm in the clouds, there's like a whole other kingdom amongst the clouds. And you say, what a mighty God you are.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, prayer is simple. And we'll have a God encounter. Nothing else is going to do it. Just your total involvement. Nothing else is going to do it. God wants to work so mightily in our lives. They're miracles that we're on the threshold. Stepping into. But our minds. But is there anybody that's had that encounter that will stand with me for God? Right where you are. Stand with me for God. Don't stand just because I said stand. I said a God encounter. The one that changes your life forever. Listen, it's the type of encounter that even when you feel like you're losing it, you refuse to turn your back on God. That's what a God encounter will do for you. When everybody else is saying just do you, something in you won't let you do it. A God encounter. The one that causes you to defame yourself and to extend your attention to the King of Kings. To kick off your smelly shoes and rest your feet in a holy place. If you've had that encounter, I don't need to give you instructions. Behold your face. Shine on me. Lord, be gracious. With the light of your
shine on me.
You saved a wretch like me, Lord Jesus. I wasn't looking for you, but you kept your eyes for me.
Thank you.
will settle with good ground in the hearts of your people. And you will lift up our esteem. Restore us in our identity in you. Thank you, God, for victory. I thank you for victory. I thank you for renewed communion with you. I thank you for renewed focus. I thank you, God, that you're strengthening people's passion for prayer. I thank you, God, that you're strengthening the passion to engage in your word. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, God, that you're giving boldness to those that need boldness to look at individuals in their eyes, no longer in fear or intimidation. Hallelujah. I thank you that you're breaking that spirit of inferiority from off of their hearts. I thank you, Father God, that you're removing the mentality of weakness and enslavement. I thank you that you're breaking the power of the enemy. That God, that we're being renewed. You said, now the Lord is that spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. And then you said, we're being changed, we're being metamorphosed, we're being translated, oh God, into the same image of God, from glory to glory, by the spirit of the Lord that gives us liberty. We thank you. And we seal it in the blood of the Lamb, in the name of Jesus Christ, Yeshua, we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Give God a hand clap.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Woo! To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power.
Come on. Come on, you declare it.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
There is power
in the name.
In the name of Jesus.
We know where it is to break
every chain.
Break every chain.
Break every chain.
Break every chain. Come on, say to break every chain.
Break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain.
There's an army rising up. There's an army.